deserve all that, man.
All right, Ralph.
I owe you my career.
Uh-oh. Remember the first time I met you, you work on Alan Thicke.
Yeah, I was Alan Thicke's Ed McMahon.
Yeah, well,
yeah.
You've progressed beyond that, that's for sure.
Yeah, I'm trying to hang in here. And see, a lot of people, those of you who don't know this story, Frank Zappa canceled one night at the Late Show, and...
Now, wait a minute. It wasn't exactly like that.
Okay, you tell me what happened before they brought me in.
Yeah, what happened was Fox wanted me to replace Joan Rivers on a Friday night.
Mm-hmm.
And they had been planning this show for about 3 weeks. And I had chosen all my own guests, and I had this strange little program set up for them. And on the Wednesday before the Friday, when they were supposed to do the show,
mm-hmm.
they panicked. And
what kind of guests did you have?
I was going to have Daniel Shore. This show was going to go on the air right after the Iran-Contra hearings had been finished.
Mm-hmm.
And Daniel Shore had been covering the Contra hearings for National Public Radio, and so he really knew what was going on there. And I wanted to, you know, get somebody on the air who could tell the real deal.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a guy who was the producer of Pat Robertson's 700 Club, who was going to tell some of the secret inside poop about what Pat Robertson was really into. And I was going to bring the synclavier on the show and do some of that kind of music. And I, you know, it was a well-rounded, different sort of a show. But they panicked over it, and they were going to do a rerun. And then somebody said, let's get Arsenio home.
Yeah. Well, they tried a few other people. They like, tried some people. They dialed 1-800-Caucasian and nobody answered. And
they never do.
Yeah, you know, so they kind of had to call me. Because I had a monologue ready, you know, I'd wanted to do that. So I kind of owe you for putting together a weird show.
Well, actually, then part of that has to go to Daniel Shore, because maybe it was the thought of Daniel coming on there telling about that stuff that really scared him. I don't know. Anyway, I'm glad you got this show, and I hope it's going to be successful.
Yeah, man. I saw your daughter the other night.
Mm-hmm.
I was at some basketball game for charity, celebrity game or whatever. Did you ever regret the names Dweezil and Moon Unit? I mean, do you ever look back and say, why didn't I use Susie?
Well, I know why. I already used Susie for something else, but...
I mean, but obviously they have meanings to you.
Yeah.
What does Moon Unit mean? What's the origin of it?
Well, her middle name, Unit, is because she was the first family unit,
mm-hmm.
you know, so it's a technical name.
Yeah, yeah.
And Moon is a nice name. I mean, in other cultures, they have, girls have the word moon for a name, you know.
Mm-hmm.
In Spanish, it's Luna.
Right, so it's our ignorance that keeps us from being able to deal with it.
Let's not be too rough on our own ignorance. I mean, after all, it's the thing that makes America great. Because if we weren't incomparably ignorant, how could we have tolerated the last 8 years?
Wow. Let's take a commercial and then come back and talk about the last 8 years.
Go ahead.
Okay. The next 4 years.
Well, CBS did this little thing on the inauguration. Before the inauguration, they went around the country getting video clips of different people giving their message to George Bush. Congratulations. And they came to me for one.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to tell you what I told them. I looked in the camera and I said, now, George, been reading your lips for a few months now. Know you got a rough job ahead of you. Said you're going to be the friend of the environment, you're going to be the education president, you're going to help the homeless, you're not going to raise my taxes. Now, George, if you can do that in 4 years, I'll become a Republican and I'll campaign for you. But if you can't, I might run against you.
Yeah. Wow. you're obviously... You're obviously a Dukakis supporter.
Well, I've supported him, yes. I would say a reluctant Dukakis supporter, because the more he campaigned, the less I enjoyed it. And I think that what happened was, when Election Day finally arrived, a lot of people who maybe didn't like Bush that much had really decided that they didn't like Dukakis at all, and just said, okay, I got to vote for somebody, give it to George.
Yeah.
And I think there was a lot of that that took place. I mean, there were so many mistakes that were made by the Democrats in that campaign that you just had to scratch your head and say, how could any one party make that many mistakes in, you know, just that short period of time? It was embarrassing. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. I don't like either of the parties at this point. You know, I look at them and go, please, somebody, do say something right. Do something right just for a minute. I just don't see it happening.
Let me ask you about a song you wrote. You wrote a song about Michael Jackson. What was the origin of that whole thing?
Well, it started with a clip on CNN. This was at a time when people were talking about his most recent series of operations, and they interviewed this little black girl in New York. She was about this tall, looked like a standard Michael Jackson audience kind of a person, and the guy said, what do you think of Michael Jackson? And the girl looked into the camera and said, he ugly, he white looking. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I wrote a song about it.
Okay, I ain't gonna touch that. But interesting commentary out of the mouths of babes, .. Let's talk about
talk about the dots.
Yeah. Let's talk about Uncle Meat. What's that all about?
Well, Uncle Meat is a movie that I've been working on for about 20 years, and it's finally coming out in home video. And there's a clip that you're going to show, which is not actually part of the movie itself. Let me explain this to you. In the home video cassette, you get the movie, which is 2 hours long, and then there's this other little thing that comes at the end, which is this clip. It's like an extra. Mm-hmm. It's like the cartoon that goes with the movie.
Yeah.
And this is clay animation done by a guy named Bruce Bickford. And the music is a song from the Jazz from Hell album called Night School.
Let's check it out, Sandy. What kind of time we got? 30 seconds. Wow. I can't do nothing in 30 seconds.
Well, let's just sit here then.
Yeah.
You know, we'll do like Gene Scott does.
My name's Gene Scott.
I'm not going to say anything until you send in that money on this program.
How about it for Frank Zappa? Thanks for coming, man.
We'll be right back with Edie McClure of the Hogan family.